Hello and welcome to the second edition of BizDevOps Master Webinar Series 2017 by Solutions IQ. Solutions IQ is the world's largest and leading agile consulting company. The intent of a webinar series is to bring about some of the latest and the most buzzing themes and topics that the industry is talking about in the field of iterative and incremental development and value. Topic for today's webinar is stress-free continuous delivery using sensible information radiators, which is being presented by Vivek Ganesan. Vivek Ganesan is an agile change agent with 7 years of experience in the software industry. He has spoken at multiple conferences within India and abroad. He has also volunteered to the program committee of Agile India 2016 conference. In this session, Vivek will take you through the mechanism of human response and how taking some extra care in designing information radiators will optimize the response time of human beings to anything wrong happening in the delivery pipeline. So without any further delay, Vivek, here you go.
Thanks for the opportunity to present this webinar. So the topic that I am going to talk about today is stress-free continuous delivery using sensible information radiators. The title sounds a lot of technical gibberish to you. Wait for a minute or two, I'll explain some of the terms that I used in the title. My name is Vivek Ganesan and I work as an Agile Program Manager at a cool startup named Gainsight, and I live in Hyderabad. So without any further delay, let's get into the context. This entire webinar or the content that I'm going to present is based on, some of them is based on my experiences in practicing some technical practices in the BizDevOps area. And some of them is from the research, or some of them are from the questions that I had when I relate human behavior in my workplace environment when I practice agility as a concept. So when we talk about the title, I'm showing you the title again: stress-free continuous delivery using sensible information radiators. So there are two technical terms here which I think I should explain for the benefit of the audience who are not very much exposed to this area. The first term that I would expect to define is continuous delivery. So what is continuous delivery? If I have to tell you a parallel, I should say that continuous delivery is like a second bus stop in a big journey, right? Your entire journey, let us say, it consists of 3 stops, and the second bus stop is continuous delivery. So rather than talking about the second bus stop, let me take a minute to talk about the first bus stop. This bus stops are nothing but 3 levels of maturity in which you iteratively deliver value to the customer in a software development concept. So the first stop of the bus in the iterative development journey is called continuous integration. When you are from the waterfall world, what happens is that development happens initially, and then QA happens, or the testing happens. And then there is a phase called integration. This phase is something that is very unpleasant to a lot of people because it takes a lot of time and nobody knows what is exactly happening, which involves integration of modules that many different teams built into a single shippable product. Now, continuous integration is a philosophy where instead of integrating everything at the end of the lifecycle before the delivery, you basically shift that integration into the earlier forms and the earlier parts of the lifecycle itself, which means even if you have 5 teams, 6 teams, or whatever number of teams you have, the code that is created by all the teams is integrated into a single code base at least every sprint. This might be done using branch mergers, this might be done using pull requests, there are multiple ways in which people do it. But what continuous integration is all about is trying to de-risk the integration process as such by creating something which is working, which is testable at every sprint. So if there are, let us say, 5 teams, each team's code will be integrated at the end of every sprint, which means at the end of every sprint, you will have something known as an integration build, right? That integration build is nothing but the code, and along with that code, you will have some technical practices like automated tests, unit tests will be there, and then there might be some functional tests, and all the testing will be done, and at the end, you will have something which you can basically call as an integrated product that you can have at the end of every sprint. And typically the team start with integrating every sprint, but they increase the frequency as and when they go, which means at one point of time you will have an integration build running every night, right? All the teams' code will be integrated every night. That is a situation that is that some teams do. Now, when you have an integrated build every night, then it automatically and naturally leads you to the second step where, okay, can I have this build delivered to the customer, right? Can I deploy it to the customer? That is what the second step is. So when I say I have a build that is tested and I want it to be deployed. Now, when you have multiple teams have working separately, the nightly builds that you get will not be, will pass all the tests, but they might have unbaked features, half-baked features and everything. That is where we call it as continuous delivery, where you use feature toggles in order to mask the half-baked features, and then you introduce a push button deployment. So CD, continuous delivery, is the second station, as I told you. In the CD, what you do is, you do whatever you do in the CI, plus you basically make it deployment ready by masking all the unbaked features or half-baked features using feature toggles, and you provide a push button deployment, which means the code is ready, tested, and half-baked features are masked, and you have a push button deployment. It means at any day I can choose, okay, last night's build I'm going to deploy to customer, and I am sure that this will not cause any issues in the production environment. That stage of maturity is known as continuous delivery. Now, from continuous delivery, you can always extend that path to say, okay, why do I need a human intrusion to say whether something needs to be deployed or not? When you go to that stage of maturity, that is when you call it a CDEP or continuous deployment. So the three terms here are continuous integration, continuous delivery, and continuous deployment. In continuous deployment, the human step of integrating, like say I will go and press a push button to deploy, that step is removed, and then they say, whenever you have a deployment ready build, then automatically I'll deploy to the customer's environment. These are the three levels of maturity. When you are into CDEP state, you can easily do any kind of hypothesis testing. You can produce value at shorter intervals. Your lead time goes into very small. It can go to the level of seconds also. You might end up doing deployments like 10 deployments a day, 50 deployments a day, many things you can do. These are the things that are possible when you go through this journey. So when I talk about continuous delivery for the context of this webinar, what I mean is this central part, continuous delivery, but I will go all over the place so that you maintain the continuity in the journey. So sometimes I'll be talking about continuous integration also, sometimes I'll talk about continuous deployment also. That way you will have a continuous journey in your picture. Now, when you have a continuous deployment or continuous delivery, every team that practices continuous delivery has, or every team that practices agility in general, has something known as information radiator. This is the second technical term that we have in our title, stress-free continuous delivery using sensible information radiator. So information radiator is nothing but anything that gives out information, that radiates information to people, which means the information should be made available readily to the people who are using that particular medium. Right? Without getting into technical context, without getting into the CD context, I can show you some items, and rather than me telling whether their information radiates or not, I would ask you to take some time and check whether all these items are information radiators or not. There are six objects that are shown in your screen. One is a traffic signal, another is a wall clock, the third one is a mobile phone showing the time, current time, fourth one is a public announcement system with a big speaker, and fifth one is a LPG gas cylinder, and sixth one is a Jira software in the browser showing a Kanban board. So with what I told you whether about information radiator, something that radiates information, which of these are information radiators, or are there some things which are not information radiators? Take some time. I'll give you 5 seconds. I'll count to five. Until then, make your decision, and then let us compare whether your answer and my answer are similar. I'll just count to five. What you have to do in this 5 seconds is check whether any of these is not an information radiator. Right? I'm counting to five now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now, probably let us go one by one and see whether it is an information radiator or not. Let us talk about traffic lights first. So, traffic lights are giving out some information, right? Information radiator need not be something that is worked in a, that is in a software development context only. It can be anything. Anything that radiates information is an information radiator. Traffic lights radiate information of whether it is safe to proceed or not. Right? And how many people can see it? Anybody who is in the vicinity of the traffic light can see it and understand that information. Right? That is an information radiator. Now talk about wall clock. Wall clock also satisfies the same property. It just gives out information. It does not ask you who you are before showing you the time. It just tells you, right? Now come to the public announcement system. As long as you are in that area, you will be able to hear whatever the public announcement system tells you. The speaker gives you that information. Just that now the mode of reception is using your ears. And fourth one is about LPG. This is a little tricky because this LPG signal, this does not give you any information other than when there is some danger. You see a smell, you sense a smell when there is a gas leakage, right? And that gas leakage smell is a information that you get saying that there is a leakage. And the design of this entire system with that smell itself makes it an information radiator saying anybody who is in the area can smell it, right? So if you see the traffic light, wall clock, public announcement system and the LPG gas cylinder, all of them give you some kind of information and they don't discriminate between whom to give and whom do not, whom they should not give. And they are available for, the information is available to anybody who is near that particular area, right? Now when you come to mobile phone, right, in that case they are showing the time. In that what happens is that it gives you the information only when you look at it. It's not that it is showing all the time, right? And probably with the current mobile phones, only you can operate it, not anyone else can operate it. So it's basically a personal information, right? It is storing the information and showing when you require it. It's a pull-based mechanism. It's not that it is pushing information to you, you are pulling information based on your name, right? And second thing, this is a Kanban board. And any Kanban board, Jira, any software system, they basically store information and you have to go to that area, go to that Kanban board, visit that Kanban board in a URL in order to get the information from there, right? So, if you see my judgment of what are information generators from this list, all of us go away as information generators. The mobile phone and the Kanban board are not information generators because these are on-demand access. Whenever I want, I will go and check. Whenever I want to know the time, now I am checking how much time I have left in this webinar. So I am opening my mobile and seeing my stopwatch, right? I have 45 minutes left. I have 15 minutes done. So it's not always on. And second thing is, these are not available to all audience in the area, right? The Kanban board and the mobile phone, they are not available to all audience. They are only available to the person who can go on, who has Kanban board's Jira's access, username, password, and it's not available to anybody who is present in the area. You have to go and visit it in order to get any information from them. And more importantly, they are not available to casual onlookers, right? Anybody who does not have the intention to see that information will not be able to get the information, right? But information radiators should be able to give the information even to people who do not want the information, right? So I hope this cleared some of the misunderstanding about what information radiator and what information radiators are not. So if this mobile phone and this Kanban board are not information radiators, what are they? They also show information, right? But they show information only when you require it. It is like the refrigerator that you have at home. It stores all the food items inside you, but it will not give it to you unless you go and open the door of the refrigerator, take a look at it and pick the information. So these two fall under the category of information refrigerators. So with all this definition of information radiator and refrigerator, one thing that we can go ahead again. This is another test that I want you to take. See, this is showing a web browser with a build monitor. It shows multiple build jobs. Some things have failed, some things have passed. It shows a lot of information, right? Now with the new information you have gained, if you check that this is an information radiator or not, right? This gives you information to anybody who sees that. Now, interestingly, though it looks like an information radiator, it is sadly not an information radiator until this happens. What is this? You can see that there are people, look, there are, see, three teams are looking at it and there is a common monitor without any restrictions as to who can see that. This is a team working area. And this board is constantly displayed on a common monitor at a place where anybody in the team can view it, right? So any Jenkins build monitor or any kind of build monitor does not automatically become an information radiator. No, you cannot call it information radiator as long as one has to open the URL in their browser in order to look at what is the state of the build. It is information radiator only when it is always available, irrespective of whether somebody wants to open that or not. So that as long as you put it in the work area openly, nobody needs to open the page in the laptop. They can just see the build monitor. This is the point at which it becomes information radiator. So the moral that we have from this entire thing is that information radiator and information refrigerator are not the same. This plays a greater role when you come to stress in CD systems. We'll talk about that a little later. But the moral that I would insist upon is information radiator is the ideal thing that you want in your system, not the information refrigerator, right? And I would even go to an extent of giving a disclaimer. Information radiator need not be electronic all the time. It can even be a physical scrum board that you have on the wall, right? As long as people are using stickies and it is available to anybody who is in the office, it becomes an information radiator. The moment you say, okay, I will not have a physical scrum board, but I will use only Jira as a project management system, and anybody who wants to know anything should log into Jira, it becomes an information refrigerator. Information refrigerator is good for audit. Information refrigerator is good to do retrospectives, but information refrigerator is not good to get real-time information. That is the moral that I want to drive in here. Now, we know what is continuous delivery. We know what is information radiator. Now, at least we understand the title of this webinar clearly, if we had not understood it earlier. Now, let us delve further into what we are talking about. Now, the another point in the title is stress, right? Stress-free continuous delivery. So, when is a stress introduced in a CD system? Let me remind you what a CD system is. CD is nothing but continuous delivery, where you have continuous integration already in place, which means there are builds running every night and people are fixing builds whenever something goes up, right? And in that integration build, what will happen? It will pull the code from all the branches, integrate and run the unit tests and then run any other tests and then qualify saying integration is done or not. Now, there are multiple things that can go wrong in this entire CI system or CD system, because integration happens from multiple code bases. What if a test case fails because of an integration issue? What if a compilation issue comes because of integration? A person could have changed a variable in the class and someone else might be using the same variable, meaning that that team might not have changed the variable, right? Multiple situations could be there where a failure can happen, right? And when we say that we are doing continuous delivery, what our organization's bosses or even our customers will think, okay, we might be able to deploy at any day and say that yesterday's code changes will be there in today's build, today's deployment. So customers can basically use what I developed yesterday. That is the expectation that people will have when you say that you have a CD system. And when that expectation is broken, that I can see yesterday's code changes in today's production environment, when you break that expectation, then there is stress, because people basically say, okay, you claim to have all the changes, but you are not deploy. Then that is where stress gets introduced. Or in other words, stress gets introduced in a CD system when human responses take long. Let us say one test case failed and people do not go and fix the test case immediately. Then there is a stress that is introduced in the people's mind, right? This is where stress comes in. Now, when human responses take long, why do we need human responses? We might need human responses to correct any build failures that occur. You might even need human responses to deploy that yesterday's build into production. You remember, right? CD has a push button deployment. So these human responses take long, then that is where the CD system's whole purpose gets defeated and stress gets introduced. Now, in order to understand how to reduce the stress, let's talk about how the CD system actually looks, right? I'm just checking whether I have received any chat messages or not regarding people not being able to hear. I'm good. Okay, I can proceed. So, dynamics of a CD system. So, if you draw the elements present in a CD system in a diagram, this is how it should look. So this is the CD system, which is typically, let us call this the guy who runs the build. Let us call this guy the Jenkins, right? So this box is nothing but Jenkins or any other software or any other infrastructure element that you use in order to create a deployable component, right? Now, if there is a failure in that, if there is something some information that needs to be given to the people there, that information is given through the information radiator. This information radiator can be a build failure, build monitor that is kept in front of the entire team. It can be a big screen which just shows whether a CD pipeline is red or green. It could be just that. Now, that radiator passes on the information to observer. So the observer is basically seeing the radiator, understanding that, okay, I need to do something in order to make it right. So what he does, the observer sees the radiator, gets the information that something has failed, and he goes and makes some changes. It may be a code change, it might be something else, it might be anything to bring the system back to green. So the system goes to red, the red information goes to radiator, and seeing the radiator, the observer understands that something is wrong. He does a corrective action, and then once he does a corrective action, this is triggered back so that the CD system probably gets from red to green. This is a cycle that we are looking at. This is the dynamics of the CD system. Right? Now, when you look at this entire picture, you can divide this picture into two small subsystems. Right? Let me show you those subsystems. One subsystem is that CD system and the information radiator, which is nothing but a build monitor for now. We will talk about that later. Let us think that this radiator is nothing but a build monitor that you have kept. And observer. This is one system, which is called communication subsystem. So in this subsystem only what happens, the communication of the failure traverses, which means CD system communicates the failure information to radiator, and from radiator observer picks up the information. This is where the communication happens to this guy that something is wrong. And the second subsystem is the correction subsystem. Now that this person knows, the observer or the developer in the team or some team member knows that something is wrong, they do some corrective action. This is called correction subsystem. So going back, we have communication subsystem and correction subsystem, right? Who is there in both of these systems? The observer is there in both of the system. Observer is a linking point between communication subsystem and corrective subsystem. Now, the communication subsystem is very straightforward because this involves just the information flowing, right? And one person just listens to it. This does not involve any human action other than just looking at something, right? But if you see the corrective subsystem, this is not very straightforward because it involves a human being. We'll talk about that later, right? Now, when you want to, what are we going to do in this entire webinar is that we will have a goal of experimenting with multiple variations in the communication subsystem and say that what are the variations that provide me easy failure correction in the correction subsystem, which means what are the things that I can change in my information radiator, the way of communicating to the developers. That way, the developers can quickly turn around and fix failures. Repeating the same thing, what are the basic differences, different ways in which I can arrange my information radiators or the build monitors so that the developers can come and correct the failures quickly, because the cycle time is the only thing that we are trying to optimize here, right? Now, the correction subsystem, we said that this is not straightforward because this involves a human being. If you want to optimize this guy's behavior, right, you cannot go by rules because this involves a lot of complex, fields of science like social psychology, group dynamics, human motivation theory, and you might also want to know about the organization culture, what are the things that are going on in the organization, multiple other things. Those things are needed. So if you want to change the cycle time by just optimizing this, this might be a very big effort. Instead, what we do is, we will optimize the other subsystem and see what are the changes that are happening in the second subsystem. Right? Now, this is a lot of theory. So what we will do is, we'll try to simplify it. Right? Now this is the place, this is the way the information flows from the CD system, which is Jenkins, to the build monitor and build monitor to observer. So the whole function of communication subsystem is simply these things. By appropriate means, relay just the appropriate information to the observer. If the build is failing, just tell the observer that the build is failing using some way. If the build is passing, tell the observer that the build is passing using some way. So here you have two things, appropriate means and appropriate information. Let us take this means as variable 1 and information as variable 2 and try to come up with variable and variable 2 combinations and see how things go, right? Now, when you talk about variable 1, which is means of communication, how are we going to communicate to the developer that a build is failing? Now, you can do it using multiple things. You can do it visually, using a pipeline monitor, like build monitor I told you. And you can use it, you can do it visually using lava lamps. Some teams use lamps. If the lamp is red color, then build has failed. If the lamp is green color, then the build is passed. And there are some teams which use auditory, which means they use the sense of sound to alert people. They use sirens. And sometimes there are teams which have a PA system which will call out the names of the people, or they will just read out a message saying the build is failing, the build is failing. That is something that people can use. And there could be other means like mechanical. I saw a YouTube video where, you know, there is a system that automatically tracks the committer and shoots foam rockets at that person. Right? That is another way of doing it. It involves mechanical. And sometimes the means can be other, or it can be hybrid, where, you know, you have Slack. Many companies started using Slack as an application. It is a communication application. Now, people have Slack integrations where, you know, the build failure will automatically trigger a message in Slack and people will be able to look at it. These are the multiple variations. Now, in this webinar, if we analyze all these variations, it's not going to make justice to the time. So, in order to make justice to the time, what we will do is, we will basically analyze only the visual and auditory variables, right? Now, coming to visual information radiators, this class of information radiators are where the people understand the information using their eyes, using the sense of sight, right? Now, when I have a visual information radiator, I am pretty much talking about a build monitor. I have a monitor which shows me whether something has failed or something has passed. And that is in public display so that all the teams can see it. Now, the position of the build monitor, does it really matter, right? Take a look at this picture. This picture is nothing but a team room setup, right? And the circle of D is nothing but a developer, and K is his keyboard, which means the developer is sitting facing his keyboard. And IR is nothing but the build monitor, information radiator, which is nothing but a build monitor which is kept there. So assuming that this is a team room where there are four developers, each developer is looking at the other developer, and the information radiator is at their side. What do you think is an error? Do you think there is an error? If there is an error for easy flow of information, what is that error? I'll give you probably 5 seconds. I'll count down to 5 until you make up your mind about what is the error in this arrangement. I'll repeat the arrangement. This is a developer, and developers are looking at their keyboards. So there are four developers looking, sitting in a square formation, and there is an information radiator at their side, right? What is the error in this combination? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So the error here is that information radiator is at their sides, which means people need to turn their heads to view the monitor, right? And if you have a monitor like this, then you cannot blame people saying that they are not fixing well often. The blame cannot happen because, you know, the people are not, people have to basically turn their necks in order to see whether something is wrong or not. And this also creates a polling behavior where I have to pull the information rather than I have to intentionally on demand pull the information. I have to keep checking. Okay, turn my neck to the right, check whether it is green. Okay, do some work, then turn my neck to the right and then check. This keeps a polling behavior which is not so good also. Now, how can we change this arrangement for a better response time? If we change this arrangement to have two build monitors in opposite sides, then each one can basically lean back in their chair to see the status. They don't have to turn their necks here and there in order to see whether something is red or green. And even, let us say I am looking down into laptop monitor, there is something called peripheral vision. You will always be able to see, okay, if something is red, you easily catch your attention. Even if you are not directly looking at the build monitor, you are doing your own work. And this is also ergonomically safe because this doesn't involve, you know, craning your neck or changing your neck position very often. And how does this scale when there are multiple teams? let us say multiple teams are there, multiple developers are there, this scales very well because you should just do the same two oppositely aligned information radiator to cater these many developers. Even if the number of developers or number of teams are more, you could just do it two. This is something that you can do. So position is something that is very important. If the information radiator is positioned at a wrong place, then you will not get the quick response time because people will not look at it that often. It will not be in people's visibility all the time. People have to turn their necks to look at it, and that will result in suboptimal cycle time, suboptimal failure resolution time. This is one takeaway that I want you to go away. And second thing, role of colors. Let us say I use a build monitor and I want to show failures and successes. So what colors do I use? That is the next topic that we will talk about. Now, when you talk about build monitors, you can use multiple of them. Many teams use their own choice of build monitor. Some people use pipeline view, pipeline stage view from Jenkins. Some people just use the Jenkins build monitor. I'll share, probably the slides will be shared to you. Here the links are there. If you want to go and see how to install all these build monitors, the links are there. You can go and try it with your teams. So if you see, red and green combination is there, but not all of them are of the same shade, not all of them are of the same color, and each one has some other color. Some people have yellow, some people have gray, some people have some shaded lines. So what is it that will work? That will work for the, you know, greater impact to fast response times. That is the second topic that we will talk about. When you have to communicate something serious, when you want to talk about seriousness, there is a journal called Scientific American, right? They published an article sometime back saying how the color red influences human behavior. And I have just taken one extract. It says, drivers blocked in traffic by a red car react faster and more aggressively than drivers blocked by vehicles of other colors. So red color actually initiates action, that to an aggressive action from people. So there is no doubt about the fact that everybody is right in using red to catch attention in saying something is there, you better go and act. Now, what to do for other colors is the question. And we seem to borrow our red-green terminology from the signals that we use in trains, right? So the signals that we use in train are very clear. Red color is stop, right? And today we use green color as go. But initially it was not the case. Let me walk you through the history. The train signal system has gone through multiple versions before arriving at the current version. So the first version, the earliest version of train signals said red color is stop, and they used white for go. White is like clear, all clear, you can go. So they thought, okay, white is the best choice to say everything is clear. So let us use that white to say, okay, go, right? And that was the version one. And they wanted to use some other color to denote caution, and green was caution, which is very much opposite to what we use today. Green was the caution light. So the first version of our traffic lights included, or the railway traffic lights included, red, green and white, where red is stop, green is caution and white is go. This caused one problem where initially what happened was whenever you have a colored light, what you do is you have a white light. On top of that you put a transparent filter, which might be, you know, a plastic cover or something with that color. So red light will be produced by something like white light only. On top of that they put a red filter, which makes it look like a red light. Same thing, white light, on top of that you will put a green filter, it will make it look like a green light. This is how the lights were. Now some situations so happened that the filter on top of the red light got torn and it fell down, which means it also started looking as a white light. So there have been incidents of train crashes when the people thought that it was white and they went ahead, but it was not actually white, it was the red light that was glowing. But just since the filter had fallen off, it was shown as white and it caused train wrecks. Now people thought a little and then they came up with a different version. What they thought was, the second version is, okay, let us use green for go and red for stop and white for caution instead, which means even if the filters fall off, right, people will try with caution. That was the rationale that they used, which means even if the filters fall down, they will still see white light, which means they can still drive with caution. They will not cause, you know, mishaps is what the logic. Now, this caused another set of problems where people somehow started, at nights particularly, this white light can be mistaken for anything. This white light can be mistaken for moon, this white light can be mistaken for a star, this white light can be mistaken for any other thing, right? Because that is so apparent, that is so, very easily visible in night, and it can be mistaken for a moon. So people started driving slowly near the traffic signals all the time. Then they thought, okay, white light is not something that is helping us. So in order to make people understand that it is not moon, it is not star, it is something else, let us give another color which is in between, which is yellow, to say, okay, drive with caution. This is the history that this red, amber, green, color scheme went through. Now, if you use the same to build monitor, since we have already learned the behavior from traffic lights, red means there is something that you have to do, green means everything is okay, and yellow means something is progressing. This schematic seems to work very well because we have already learned that behavior from traffic lights. Now, there is a catch. There is a possibility that we might use the red, yellow, green scheme in a bad way also, right? So there was an article which came out in Agile Pain Relief blog where they talked about how one can basically misuse the red, yellow, green reports. Now, whenever you indicate the progress of something, which means something has not completed, at that time if you use green, typically project managers use an Excel sheet where something says not started, in progress, done, right? Or sometimes if the variance is very less, time variance is very less, use green, otherwise use red, at risk, not at risk. That kind of charts they will make. And they used to qualify red, yellow, green to things that are in progress and not already completed. And these things actually hide the truth. I'll tell you what. Let us say today you mark a project as green, and tomorrow let us say you discover something new and say that you increase your estimates. Agile does not stop you from increasing your estimates at any point of time. But then the project manager's chart will somehow suddenly turn red. And when a project turns from green to red, what happens? This creates more problems than the original ones because people get furious when green changes to red. When your estimates change, green can become red. And people live in their own psychological safety that, okay, it is green, I don't have to think about it. But suddenly on the last day of the release or one week to the release, green changes to red and all hell breaks loose, right? And in order for avoiding the fury from the people who manage the projects, teams cut corners and then they say, okay, we have anyway agreed to that estimate, let us not increase that estimate. Let us go with the existing estimate only so that, we will not get into the red zone, right? And if the teams are honest, then the project manager will come and say, yesterday you said green, today it is red. So you basically, I can't trust you guys anymore. You are untrustworthy. And then the project manager can come and say, okay, fine, I will try to manage your things hereafter. This leads to micromanagement. So the moral that you see in the red, yellow, green scheme is that you basically do not use red, yellow, green scheme for ongoing events. You can do it only to qualify completed events, which means a build, integration build has completed, and in order to signify its result, whether it is pass or fail, I can use red or green. But not while something is running, while some project is running, you cannot say, okay, I will use red, yellow, green to say whether it is safe or not safe. That does not go well with the way in which we understand things as human beings. So don't use red, yellow, green scheme to qualify ongoing events. Do it only when things have already completed. Like a build has completed, then you can say pass or fail. You can say red or green. That is something that you can do. This is what we want to talk about colors. Now we have spoken a lot about colors, right? Now we are not done with colors, not so soon. There is a statistic which comes from Color Blindness Awareness Group where they say 1 in 8 men and 1 in 200 women are colorblind. Now what does this mean? Colorblind people does not mean that they see all colors as black and white. It's not like they are seeing a black and white TV when you watch a color TV. Apparently more bad news is that most of the colorblind people cannot differentiate between red and green, right? If people cannot differentiate between red and green, I'll show you how things look for a colorblind person. So what you see in the top here is the normal vision. Okay, normal vision has one green and one red. One red is probably in progress, right? Which means past test has failed and something is in progress. And a colorblind person can see it like this. Now, will he be able to understand what is red and what is green? He will not be able to. So this red, green, just using the colors will not be helpful for a colorblind person. Remember, 1 in 8 people are colorblind. You cannot go and ask people whether are you colorblind. You might not even know. Sometimes people say that colorblind individuals themselves do not realize that they are colorblind. That is the state of affairs here, right? In such case, how do people solve these things? Jenkins Build Monitor has solved this by using multiple varieties of, you know, creative techniques. They introduced a colorblind mode in their build monitor, where any failed job, right, they have stripes on them. Which means a colorblind person can just program his mind to say, if I see stripes, something is wrong, I have to work on it. If I don't see stripes, it's okay. If you want to see a very technical and good to read discussion on how to solve colorblindness as outcome, how to handle the colorblindness problem in the build monitors, this is a link that I will also share. Just go through this link. You can see the quality of conversation that happens. This is an open source project. And in the open source project, they have a very nice conversation about the technical aspects of colorblindness, right? And the image that I created in the image that I showed you was created using a colorblindness simulator. The link is also there. I'll share the link also with you to understand how colorblindness can be simulated. Now, how did Jenkins Pipeline? Jenkins Pipeline is another product. Now, the new Jenkins for CD. Jenkins Build Monitor is a CI tool. Jenkins Pipeline is a CD tool, right? Now, Jenkins Pipeline solved it using additional text and loss of shading. If there are no shades, then something is wrong. If there are shades, then something is right. That is a program that a colorblind person can get into. And there is extra text also in the bottom saying something has failed. And anything in progress will have stripes, right? This is another tool which solved colorblindness using something. So, the bottom line message that I want to drive here is, remember the 1 out of 8 men around you, because 1 out of 200 is still, you know, something that is statistically not as significant as 1 out of 8 men. Use an information radiator that doesn't leave out the colorblind, right? And this is where we finish the topic of visual information radiators, and we will enter into auditory, which means you will use the sense of ears in order to understand what is going on, right? Now, when you talk about auditory information radiators, the system should use sound to communicate the failure message to people. Now, when you use sound and when you want to capture people's attention, there are ways to do it. Let us explore some aspects of it. One question that I want to ask is, we all have ringtones for our mobile phones, right? And most of them turn out to be music. Why don't we just, you know, open a recorder and talk something and use that use that speaking voice as a ringtone? Why do we always use musical ringtones? Why don't we use some dialogues as ringtones? Even when people use dialogues, they are very distinct, right? Why we use musical ringtones is because human beings want your attention to be captured when the phone rings. So you use musical ringtones because it will be distinct from surroundings. It's not very common that, you know, your surroundings will be playing the same music that you, unless you are in a party or some other place where we put our mobile phones in vibration or switch off mode. There is no guarantee that, there is no possibility that somebody will be always playing the music that you have as a ringtone. So you put musical ringtones because it is distinct from the surroundings. Similarly, when you have an information radiator which uses sound to convey information to people, you should use sounds that are distinct from the surroundings. You cannot just use human voice, which is normal human voice, at a volume which is very similar to the volume that is presented. You cannot just use the voice levels at the same level as what is happening on the floor. Let us say people talk in 10 decibels or whatever. I'm not very good with numbers of decibels, but I'm just for the sake of saying 10 decibels in the floor. You cannot just have your build monitor talk at 10 decibels as well. You should at least be at a higher volume. It should have some distinct quality. It should sound in a different way than the regular chatter that happens in the area. That is one point. So you should always have sounds which are distinct from surroundings. Otherwise, people will not catch that information. And when they don't catch that information, then they will basically respond very slowly to the system. So in order to improve the response time, your nodes should always be distinct from the surroundings. There is a second aspect of auditory information radiators, which use sound. And before that, I want to play a sound clip to you. This sound clip is something, the audio might be very feeble, so you might want to increase your volumes while I play this audio. And this might be very familiar to a lot of you. So let me play that audio, and after that I'll continue what I was saying. This is an audio, you might want to increase your volume so that you can increase it, you can hear it properly. So what you heard here was a railway station announcement. It starts with the music, right, always. There is a music at the beginning of railway station announcement. Why is it? Because it helps uniquely identifying announcement from other noises and human voices. When you hear the sound, you get alert, okay, something is going to come. Some information is going to come to you, right? Similarly, you should use this music or any other audio pieces as attention catchers when you design an information radiator which uses sound. It's not just possible to just add human voice and expect people to pay attention to it. That is the second point that I want to drive upon. So we talked about visual information radiators and sound information radiators. But auditory alone is always not enough. Whenever you hear a sound, let's say a build is failing, people should also be able to have a system where they can look at to see what is failing. So it always means that when people hear the message that something is failing, they should have a system ready where they can go and see. So first they use their ears and then they use their eyes to see what is happening, what is wrong. So that the auditory will always forward you to visual ones. That is another thing that we have to remember. Now, going back to our earlier diagram, we talked about variable 1 and that is done. And variable 2, it has very less information. I can cover it in the next 5 minutes. Let's talk about variable 2 and what are its variations and how can variable 2 can increase the performance in terms of how fast people respond to build failures. In the level of information, the basic information that you show on a build monitor is whether something passed or failed. That is the basic information that you have. If you don't have this information, nobody will, you know, respond to anything. That is the basic information. Second is latest committer. If you have this information, there are some advantages as well as disadvantages. Advantages is that you will know whom to talk to. Second disadvantage is that people might get into a blame game, which is actually bad. When it comes to CD, then there are other side effects that happen. There is a article that I keep writing about blameless CI, blameless continuous integration, which talks about all the bad effects of showing or blaming the last committer for a build failure. So you have to use this information with caution depending on whether your organization has a blame game culture or not. Third information that you will display is qualifiers. Sometimes if you claim the build to be bad because it has less code coverage, then it makes sense to show the code coverage percentage also in the build monitor itself, so that people don't have to go and fish around. Let us say some test fail. It makes sense to show which tests fail also in the build monitor, depending on how many tests fail, of course. So those are qualifiers, which qualify a build as pass or fail. That is some other information you can have. And the fourth information is if somebody has claimed a build failure, right, you can show that person's name also, so that other people do not again look at the same build failure. This way, if you have all this information based on your organization context, then people basically can easily go ahead and respond faster depending on what level of information they need in order to fix the bill. So these are the things that I wanted to cover as a part of this entire webinar. So a short summary of what we did today is we talked about 3 stops in the journey of agility: CI, continuous integration, CD with the push button deployment, and CDEP, which is continuous deployment where there is no push button, everything is deployed automatically. And we talked about difference between information radiator and information refrigerator. And we talked about there are 2 subsystems. One is the information subsystem and the second communication subsystem. And the second subsystem is the correction subsystem. And we were talking about how we can change the communication subsystem so that correction subsystem acts faster. We talked about visual information radiators, how position matters, and it should be visible to all people so that people need not turn their necks in order to see the failure or pass. And we talked about colors very extensively, red, yellow, green, the nature of them, how did they start, the traffic signal analogy, and case of color blindness and how red and green are a bad choice for colorblind people, and how you can misuse the red, yellow, green scheme for something that is in progress. When you are doing something in progress, don't use red, yellow, green. For something that has already completed, use red, yellow, green. This is something that we spoke about. And then we talked about information radiators which use your ears in the form of sound. You should have some distinctness from the surroundings, and you should have uniqueness factor like catching the attention using some music, some unique tone, so that people take their attention, very much like the railway announcement signal. And the principle that once it is auditory information is conveyed that something is failing, you should always have a visual medium ready where people can go and see as to what failed. Auditory always forwards to visual. And regarding the level of information, which is the variable 2, we talked about whether pass fail should be there or not, which is a bare minimum information. Committer list can be there based on whether blame game is warranted or not. And qualifiers like coverage or any other thing that qualifies the build as pass or fail. And the fourth thing is, we basically do not need to have all the information. If you want to put all the logs into the entire build, right, the build monitor is not going to look easy to read. So avoid detailed information, use only summary information in the build monitor. These are the things that I wanted to talk about.